I love myself a good thermos. Put ice water in it before you go to bed, and it'll be cold all night long. How do thermoses do it? Well, there's two secrets. The first one is nothing. That's right, nothing. Think about what's in the walls of these thermoses. Between the metal walls, there's a vacuum, which means the air has been pumped out of it. And that reduces the rate at which heat gets into your cold ice water. The second secret is the ice itself. Because even though you can design a thermos really well, heat will still sneak in. But the ice cubes act like these giant vacuums, sucking up the heat that sneaks in. In fact, the ice does such a good job, it keeps it really cold all night at exactly 32 degrees Fahrenheit. Measure it, I dare you. So the ice absorbs all of that energy, and that's actually just what we're going to take a look at in this lab. We're going to see how much energy it takes to melt an ice cube. Let's take a look at just how cool science can be. Let's begin by reviewing our lesson objectives. First, we'll introduce the required materials. Then, we'll introduce the lab procedure. And lastly, we'll provide some tips for the post-lab calculations. Well, let's start with the required materials. For this lab, you need ice cubes. In fact, the whole lab centers on how much energy it takes to melt ice cubes. We need to know the mass of those ice cubes, so we'll need a digital scale. And then we need to insulate those ice cubes. To do that, we'll place them in coffee cups. You'll actually stack these two coffee cups, one on top of the other, so you only need one lid. Now, if you don't have disposable coffee cups, a good substitute is a travel coffee mug. If it's insulated and it has a top, it's perfect. You're going to stick a digital thermometer inside those coffee cups to measure the change in the temperature of water. This digital thermometer needs to include down to 0 degrees Celsius. So a thermometer that's used for measuring fevers, for example, won't work. Usually a meat thermometer would be a good choice. Here's the materials to gather. If you're ready to continue with the lab, go ahead and pause the video and gather all these items and then come back and finish the lesson. Though you might want to leave your ice in the freezer. That's probably a good idea. No need to melt it too soon. So here's the idea. We know that when I put ice in water, that water stays very cold. It turns out that's because heat flows from the liquid water to the ice, and that heat is absorbed in melting the ice. What we want to know, our big question, is how much heat does it take to melt ice? Here's how we're going to figure that out. We're going to construct the coffee cup calorimeter, which sounds pretty fancy and scary, but really it's just a stack of coffee cups. Let's take a look at how we make it. We're going to stack two coffee cups on top of each other. Of course, if you have the travel mug, no stacking necessary. And then we're just going to put the lid on top and insert the thermometer through the lid. You can make a hole in the lid or use the drinking hole, and that's great too. There'll be no stir, but otherwise the setup you see on the left should be quite similar. Then we're going to record the mass of the water. So you're going to take liquid water and you're going to add it to that coffee cup calorimeter. You're going to add about 240 grams of water. Then we'll measure the initial temperature in Celsius. So that's where our thermometer comes into play. It should be somewhere near room temperature. We're going to record the mass of ice. It's about 40 grams. So it can be a little above or below that, but should be about 40 grams. Next, we're going to add the ice to the calorimeter, replace the lid, and then you can gently swirl it until the ice is melted. Then we want to record the final or lowest temperature of the water. So over time, the ice is going to cool the water and the ice is going to melt. And we want to record the lowest temperature of the water. Here's a pro tip. If the water reaches 0 degrees Celsius, restart the experiment with less ice. That basically means that your water has dropped to freezing temperature and your ice won't melt. All right, well, let's get on with our post-lab calculations. The goal is how much heat is needed to melt ice. We want to calculate that. We're going to calculate that per mole. Because this is a chemistry class, we love moles here. Now, the nerd speak for all of this is we're going to determine the enthalpy of fusion. That's just the energy needed to melt ice per mole. And we use a delta H, a little triangle with an H. Remember that triangle is the Greek letter delta, which means change. So pretty much we're just looking at the energy needed to melt ice. It has a fancy name. How are we going to do this? Well, we're going to determine the heat lost by water. So remember that the water dropped in temperature, and we want to determine how much heat the liquid water lost. We're going to multiply that heat by -1, and I'll explain why in a minute. Then we'll calculate moles of ice, so we need to know the moles of ice that were melted, and we're going to divide the heat by moles. All right, let's go through that calculation one step at a time. First, we want to determine the heat lost by water. To do that, we're going to use our heat capacity equation, which says Q equals mCat. Is a nice way to remember it. Q equals mCS delta T. The Q stands for heat. So this is our heat capacity equation, and we'll be calculating how much heat was lost by our liquid water. M is the mass of water. That's the mass of our liquid water, which is about 240 grams. CS is our heat capacity, which is 4.184 joules per gram degree Celsius. And the triangle T is delta T, or the change in temperature. So here are the two equations ultimately that we need. We need to do mass times our heat capacity times our change in temperature. So you'll plug in the final temperature that you got and subtract your initial temperature. But here's the deal. Remember, because your temperature started warm and got cold, delta T will be negative. So just a little pro tip here, delta T will be negative, and that's going to make your Q negative. Then we're going to multiply our heat by -1. Why are we doing that? Well, remember, what we're measuring with our thermometer in our coffee cup is the temperature in liquid water. So we're measuring the temperature of liquid water. But we want the heat absorbed by the ice. And remember, heat is flowing from the liquid water to the solid water. And that means that the heat lost by water is exactly equal and opposite to the heat gained by the ice, which we can express with this fancy math equation. Negative Q of the water is equal to Q of the ice. So let me just give you an example with a made-up number. This won't be your number. Let's say that after you calculate Q for your water, you get negative 300 joules, and your number should be negative. Well, all we're going to do is add a negative sign to the heat. We're going to flip it around. So Q ice is going to be positive 300 joules. Such a small step, but it can be confusing. So basically, after you determine the heat absorbed by water, you're going to flip that sign. Then we want to calculate the moles of ice that were melted. Remember, the whole goal is to determine the heat needed to melt a mole of ice. So we need the moles. The mass of your ice should have been about 40 grams. You'll take your exact mass and combine that with the molar mass of water, which is 18.02 grams per mole, to get moles. Once you have moles, you'll divide the heat by your moles. So here's the last step. The enthalpy of fusion is equal to the heat that was absorbed by the ice divided by the moles of ice that you have. Here's the true value, 6,020 joules per mole. So to melt a single mole of ice takes 6,020 joules. See how close you can get. Here's what we've learned. We introduced the required materials. Then we introduced the lab procedure where we saw that we'll be melting ice in liquid water in a coffee cup and measuring the temperature to see how much heat it takes to melt the ice. And then we provided some tips for the post-lab calculations. You'll probably want to come back here and re-watch those calculation steps when it comes time to actually determine your enthalpy. Good luck on your experiment. Hey, hey.